So we're going to start today with the metadata, okay? That's this component here. But before we get to the fun part, why metadata? Well, we're going to look at some of the standards. We're going to look at this, the schema that the IPT uses, based on EML. The preparation metadata, where does it go? And some examples. So let's start with the first one. Why metadata? So, there is an awful lot of data out there these days. How do you discover really what it is you want to find? Well, the key requirement is that you have high quality metadata with long term duration and use for your data sets. So, here we've got an interesting graph. I hope you can all see it. I'm just going to plug in the pointers so that I can have this. So imagine here today that you have published your data set, okay? Your time of publication. It's very fresh in your mind what your data set is all about, which sampling methods you used, which bibliographic references you used. But over time, it's human nature to start to forget these little details. So imagine that you never wrote these things down. Over time, as we move on, the information that we remember about our data set will continually decrease. Here's retirement or career change. You can see it's already dropped steadily. Here's a scary one, death. And you can see over here that the amount of information that we actually remember about our original data set has decreased quite a lot. So, it's good practice to write down as much about our data set as we can remember while it's still fresh in our mind. I'll put it up to the audience. Who has a data set from a year ago that they haven't looked at for a while? Do you remember everything about that data set? Yes? You shake your head, yes? Now imagine in 50 years, will you still remember as much information about that data set? Yes? Okay, you have an exceptional memory, I guess. But the rest of us, probably not so. So, if we've documented as much about our data set as possible, what will it allow us to do? Well, it will support users to discover your data set, to interpret it, evaluate it, understand where it came from, what quality of data you have, what its fitness for use is. And it will enable your data to be reused again and again and again, even if you haven't seen that data in 50 years, you retire, and you're going to go to the beach now to never look at data ever again for the rest of your life. But at least you can sit comfortably on the beach knowing that all your data sets have been well documented and are fit to be reused. So, the different metadata standards that exist out there, I'm not going to try and go through all of them in detail, but just to give you an idea that there are lots, okay, such as EML, and that's the one that GPIF in a metadata schema is based on primarily stubborn core, directory interchange format, some ISO formats, natural collections description, which gives you the metadata schema is also a drawing part. Total geographic directory, multimedia resources, metadata schema. So it's pretty difficult to get people in every corner of the world to agree on how to enter their metadata. There's so many choices out there. So the best that we can do is recommend that when you're describing your data, that you provide the discovery level metadata in English, so the common scientific language to describe data sets is English. At least the discovery level metadata, your title, the description. So we have a special profile called the GBIF email profile, the GBIF metadata profile. And since we were going to incorporate some metadata offering inside our publishing tool, IPT, we wanted to basically provide as rich of a metadata schema as possible without going overboard, without providing you with 100 different pages of metadata to fill in. So we need the essential metadata that would allow your data set to be described in as great a detail as possible without confusing users too much. So there was a task group that was convened and a lot of people went and convened on this to come up with this schema. And all you guys need to know is that that is the schema that the IPT is publishing that its metadata using. And if you're interested, there's additional documentation online that you can look at to learn more about what it contains. So, talking about the preparation of metadata, we know that we're going to use the IPT tool today. There's also the spreadsheet template that we used on day one. There's another tool called Morpho, mostly. But really, we're only going to concentrate on the first two in this workshop. You could also use some scripting to prepare your metadata, but I think this is quite error-prone and even more error-prone is to actually author your metadata directly. And I've seen this happen quite often where people are authoring their own metadata in XML but they forget to validate it and they publish something that's not a valid XML document and then they have to go back and fix it unless we find out that it's invalid. So, imagine you've prepared your metadata using the GBIF spreadsheet, or you've prepared your metadata using the IPT. Where does it go once you've registered it? Well, one place that your metadata goes is the metadata catalog at GBIF. So there's a special catalog just for the metadata for data sets in GBIF. The other place is the data portal. So when you're looking at a data set page, you get to see quite a lot of metadata there. and we're working on a new version of the data model that is going to combine basically everything that you enter in the IPT on the dataset resource detail page. There's also the registry, which is also another point to discover. So there's these three places where your metadata will go automatically as soon as you register it with G. So if we look at sources of existing data sets and metadata inside throughout the world right now, we've got some external networks and registries, such as the knowledge network for biocomplexity, biodiversity collections index, and biodiversity heritage library. So we can harvest metadata from those sources. There's also all the data sets that have been registered through IT, IPT installations in the world. There are national, regional, organizational level metadata catalogs and the meta catalogs. Now, the part down here in red is the important one. And it's to say that when we're harvesting metadata from all these different sources in the world, it doesn't necessarily have to be in the GBIF ENS unit. So there's no imposed metadata standard. Our approach is we don't impose any standard or preferred catalog implementation. But in accepting all these different formats of metadata, we still have to try not to lose any information when we're converting from one format to another. Now, I'm going to skip over this because probably your institutions wouldn't be interested in hosting one. Server to serve metadata. What you guys will hopefully be interested in doing is publishing your metadata using the IPT. So let's do the first one together. Part three. So if you go now, turn to part three of your book. Basic resources in IPT. The exercises that we have to do here are goals 1 and 2. So goal 1 is publish a metadata-only resource. And goal number 2 is publish a metadata-only resource by first importing an existing ENL file. Let's take it from the very beginning, okay? If you haven't logged in yet, you want to visit this address, ipt.gbif.org. I've created an account for everybody in the room, and we've noticed that everybody now has successfully logged in, which is great. So I'll log in too. Now, on the home page, you're going to see all of the publicly listed resources that have been being served by your IPT already. Let's go to the Manage Resources tab, which is where you as a manager manage your own resources that you have the right to see. So what you would see is this part, create a new resource. Has everybody navigated to this part? Yes? All right, so let's look at this part of the talk. I'm going to blow it up so we all can see it a little bit more clearly. So, to create a new resource, you can upload an existing resource as a zipped download or archive, just like the one that the Jupyter spreadsheet processor outputted for us. Remember on day one? You can also upload an existing IPT resource using a zipped resource configuration folder. Just ignore that for now. Alright? And the name that you give your resource here, it should be short, okay? And the only restriction is that it has to use alphanumeric characters, hyphens, or underscores. It cannot contain any spaces. So, if I have, I don't know what's a good name for your resource, so test resource 1. Is that a valid name? No, actually it's invalid because I have some spaces in there. Great, okay. So this should work this time, right? And you can see up at the top here that the short name for your resource will appear in your resource URLs. So shorter the better, I would say, just to make it easier.